Schedule. Columbia's crew commander Rick Husband, pilot Willie McCool, and mission specialists Michael Anderson, Kalpna Chavla, Dave Brown, Laurel Clark, and Israeli astronaut Ilan Ramon would not go to the International Space Station. Their flight would require nothing more risky than orbiting the Earth.
Booster ignition and liftoff of Space Shuttle Columbia with a multitude of national and international space research experiments.
82 seconds after launch, what was later described as a suitcase-sized chunk of frozen foam insulation breaks off Columbia's external tank and strikes the leading edge of the orbiter's left wing.
Roger, roll, Columbia.
A routine same-day video review of the launch would reveal nothing unusual. However, higher resolution tracking camera film processed overnight and reviewed on flight day two by the mission's ascent team showed otherwise.
You saw this little thing float toward the leading edge of the wing and like, it was like a snowball hitting something and then just being pulverized. But when you saw it hit, we just winced. Because we knew, the vehicle's going 500 miles an hour or better. It was inconceivable in hindsight that you could have that kind of impact at the speed that the vehicle was going and assume that there was no damage. And that's what we allowed ourselves to feel comfortable that we were right and we were dead wrong.
Due to limitations in the visual clarity, the exact point of impact and extent of any damage could not be determined. If the foam strike had compromised Columbia's integrity, little, if anything, could be done to repair the orbiter in space. 1 week after launch, Mission Control emails the crew, informing them of the debris strike. Save for a relatively minor problem with a leaky refrigeration unit, STS-107 had been without further incident. As scheduled, the order is given on the morning of February 1st for the Columbia crew to begin the landing procedure and come home to Florida. Traveling in excess of 12,000 miles per hour, the orbiter's belly begins to glow red as it descends into Earth's atmosphere.
FYI, I've just lost four separate temperature transducers on the left side of the vehicle, hydraulic return temperatures.
As reentry started and as the ground track went across the states, the ground track, of course, changes color. You can tell where the shuttle is over what part of the country it is. Well, that display stopped updating. In other words, that display froze in a certain position. Well, sometimes you have loss of data, you have some problem with the system on the ground where you'll have those kind of outages temporarily. Well, this lasted a bit longer. Then the call went up to the crew, a call went up and no response. Well, I don't know, I just began to feel uneasy.
Columbia, Houston, UHF comm check.
At speeds above Mach 20, the stress becomes too much for the orbiter.
We do not have any valid data at this time.
The suitcase-sized chunk of foam had indeed punched a bowling ball-sized hole in the leading edge of Columbia's left wing. Within seconds, internal temperatures spike, signaling the cascade of structural disintegration. Only 16 minutes from home, Space Shuttle Columbia breaks apart in the skies over East Texas. All seven crew members are lost.
GC flight.
Fly GC. Lock the doors. Copy.
And at that moment, I knew we lost them.
The grief is heavy. Our nation shares in your sorrow and in your pride. And today we remember not only one moment of tragedy, but seven lives of great purpose and achievement.
Within days, hundreds of professionals from federal and state agencies across the country arrive in East Texas. They are joined by local volunteers to help NASA recover and catalog debris from Columbia in the hopes of, literally, piecing together an answer to the accident's cause.
This is one of the many obstacles investigators are up against.
It was really heartwarming and very emotional for me to see all of these people from around the country come in to the Piney Woods of East Texas and spend days and weeks there marching out through these through the woods looking for bits and pieces of the orbiter and so forth. If anybody ever wonders about the strength of the backbone of this country, then they ought to have the privilege, like I do, to meet these people who have come here to do this. It shows you the fabric of what this country is made of.
Determined to return to flight, stronger and safer, the grounded shuttle program had taken a fresh look at itself.
During my watch, we lost the Columbia crew, and clearly as a flight director back in Challenger, we lost that crew. I think about those every day. Every day I come to work, I need to be very vigilant, I need to pay attention, and I need the people that work for us in this business to pay attention to what they're doing, because this is hard stuff that we do. It's very dangerous. We have not figured out a way to do a beam me up Scotty. Right now it takes a lot of hydrocarbons, moving at very high speeds through fuel pumps at very high temperatures, high pressures, to get into space. And it takes a tremendous amount of effort to get out of space, back in the atmosphere, and get home.
I was sent out to David Brown's parents' home. I'll never forget this moment when Judge Brown looked at me and said, "Leland, my son is gone. There is nothing you can do to bring him back. But the biggest tragedy would be if you don't continue to fly and carry on his legacy."
Each of the remaining three orbiters was pulled apart and refurbished. New capabilities were devised for the crew and mission controllers to assess and repair damage while on orbit. Processes and procedures were also re-examined and reinvigorated. Crew safety would never again be taken for granted. Nearly 2.5 years would pass before the nation would see another orbiter poised for launch from the Kennedy Space Center.
By the time that we fly the flight, it's something that it feels like we have flown many times. So if things don't go well, it becomes very, very natural for us to know at certain points during the mission, if this doesn't go well, or if this significant system breaks, or we have this type of emergency, what's the most important thing we need to do now? Because we've been rehearsing it. And it makes it look really easy. You don't really get the full effect of how much real preparation, how much real studying went into making it look that easy.
Of all the changes accompanying the shuttle's return to flight, none was more significant than the one announced in early 2004 at NASA headquarters by President Bush.
Our first goal is to complete the International Space Station by 2010. We will finish what we have started. We will meet our obligations to our 15 international partners on this project. The shuttle's chief purpose over the next several years will be to help finish assembly of the International Space Station. In 2010, the space shuttle, after nearly 30 years of duty, will be retired from service.
Even though each shuttle was designed to fly 100 missions, the Columbia Accident Investigation Board called the shuttle an aging spacecraft, with the odds of losing another orbiter and crew increasing with each subsequent flight. NASA's human spaceflight program was faced with several basic challenges, including coming up with a successor to the shuttle fleet. However, with an impending cancellation of the shuttle program looming, shuttle managers recommitted themselves to the paramount task of safely completing the International Space Station. It would become the program's mantra to be repeated over and over again, not only to the media, but also for every worker in the shuttle program. No launch schedule was too tight, and no mission too important to be rushed.
We ought to treat every flight, in a sense, as a return to flight. This is truly a test program. We go back, we make sure everything is right, we double check, and then we go commit in a flight readiness review that we're actually ready to go fly.
On July 26, 2005, Discovery gets the shuttle program flying again.
This is shuttle launch control at T-minus 3 hours is our pilot. We're now into the suit-up room. Gucci.
LRD is go.
SRO.
SRO is go. So on behalf of the many millions of people who believe so deeply in what we do, good luck, Godspeed, and have a little fun up there.
Well, thanks to you, to the launch team, and to everybody in the shuttle program. The crew is go for launch.
T-minus 10 seconds, go for main engine start. 7, 6, 5, 3 engines up and burning. 3, 2, 1, and liftoff of Space Shuttle Discovery, beginning America's new journey, and the vehicle has cleared the tower.
Among the many changes instituted, the new R-bar pitch maneuver, or backflip.
Station Discovery initiating RPM in 3, 2, 1, mark.
Will be used by each mission to the International Space Station. At arrival, the end-over-end flip allows the station crew to visually document the condition of the shuttle's belly and nose. Discovery and the STS-114 crew safely began the final phase of the shuttle program's historic journey with a smooth pre-dawn landing on August 9, 2005 at the Edwards Air Force Base, California.
Stevie Ray, Suichi, Andy, Vegas, Charlie, Wendy, and Eileen, welcome home, friends.
With this practically rebuilt space transportation system, each remaining shuttle mission would be safer than the one before, and its final flight, the safest.
It's almost like we've had kind of three different space shuttle programs. First 10 years, we're off learning how to fly the thing, deploying satellites and flying laboratories in the back. Next 10 years, we're doing more of that. And we're going out on more and more spacewalks, and we fly up to the Mir space station. And in the last 10 years, we use it to build about a million-pound space station in orbit, which wouldn't have been possible without Shuttle. It's a heck of a machine.
When you look at the Hubble Space Telescope, that would not have been possible without Shuttle. And you look at the International Space Station, which certainly would not have been possible without Shuttle. Every launch is an emotional experience. Watching what this nation has done, what NASA has done with the NASA contractor team. It's awesome. It's wonderful.
We didn't spend a dime in space. Not one single penny has been spent in space. Every single penny that went into the space shuttle program over its 30 plus years was spent right here on Earth. One, creating jobs, growing our economy, creating technological development of which we never dreamed, advancing science, and technology, even advancing the field of aeronautics.
It just impresses me what people can do. What people can do. It's a big machine. It's a nice machine. It's a fantastic engineering marvel, in my opinion, the whole space shuttle. But what's the real marvel is the people behind it that make it go.
Having a space shuttle enabled us to be able to complete our science and do some really great things to advance the area of metallurgy.
Without the space shuttle, an experiment like this one could not have been conducted. The shuttle is very important for us to learn and be able to conduct long period experiments.
Out of the 50 states, 48 of them have vendors that provide parts or equipment to the space shuttle program. So it's a vast cross-section of America that makes the American space program what it is.
Change is inevitable. As much as people don't like change, it's the only thing that's constant in our lives. And we have to change, we have to transition from shuttle to a new future, which we're going to define, which can be even better. A future that allows us to explore beyond our home planet, to seek our destiny, to learn what we couldn't possibly learn if we were stuck in low Earth orbit.
And since its return to flight, the shuttle program has been almost singularly